good morning. Welcome to First United Methodist Church in Normangee. It is May the 30th, last Sunday of May. We're going to start with I Stand Amazed in the Presence. I invite you to stand. The hymn is 371.
Wonderful words of life.
be seated.
Good morning. I like having a full house. I think we have more than 60 people here today. Okay, birthday. Ricky, stand up. Her birthday's tomorrow. Anybody else have a birthday this week we don't know about? Some of you are not telling the truth. Some of y'all never stand up. Let's sing happy birthday to Rachel. Committee going to Nationals in North Carolina. And speaking of that, tomorrow they're having a fundraiser. And it's a putt-putt golf at Hilltop. So if you want tickets or anything, get me off to the side and I'll show you everything I know. It's a fundraiser. And I know they've already gotten $1,000 in donations. And the five kids are going. Miss De La Garza is not. She's going to see her brother off into another adventure. But there's five girls going to represent Nationals in North Carolina with our golf team. The boys can't go because two of the boys have to do something with their college careers. Any other happy joys? Anything? Oh, Mr. Bruner?
Hey, Bart, tell him Sheriff are with
him. Y'all stand up. He doesn't want y'all left out. The Bruners have their kids here. Y'all give them a hand.
I'm not a regular yet.
Yeah, you can be a regular, but it's also nice to be recognized. Also, Gary, can you stand up and wave at everybody and show them you're alive and well? Who else haven't we seen in a long time? The Stevens? Yeah, they were here yesterday and last week. Wave, Mr. Stevens. They can't see you. He can't hear me. Okay, did we overlook anybody?
I have a concern.
Okay.
Yesterday, and I know we haven't had any activities in the fellowship hall, but we had the luncheon yesterday, and there's no cup towels and no washcloths in there. Maybe five. And I'm thinking maybe somebody took them home a year ago or so and forgot to bring them back. But we have no cup towels. If anybody wants to donate, maybe we have seven. So if anybody wants to donate some washcloths or cup towels, we need them.
Okay. Any other things we need to announce? Okay, here's our prayers this week. Tammy De La Garza's mom, Linda Brown's aunt, Elizabeth.
She's doing better.
And how old is she?
She'll be 101 in August.
Wow. In August. Okay, I just like to hear that ring. Marsha's brother-in-law, Ron Bansetch. Okay. Sheila Smith's cousin, Charles. Rick and Sandy Clary's have health issues. Taylor Chalk, grandson of Barbara. Ernest Randall, friend of Ernie and Lloyd's. Letha's step-great-grandson, Seth. Mark and Stacy Bennett. Also, y'all pray for Bo Bennett, because he's not doing too well. Rob Parker and daughter in hospital because of the tornado. Lloyd's family from Calvert. And Tristan Gotrue, my Tristan's uncle, who's in San Antonio. Anybody else? Oh, Barbara Shamira, Sarah Lundy, Gerald Weiss, and the Friedman family.
What about the family that lost their house with the lightning strike here? Do you know anything about that?
I heard it was the Sward family, SWORD.
I know it was. I just saw
it. Well, they lived on Dawkins Road. The lightning hit it and burned it to the ground. But I don't know who that is.
They don't think they had four kids.
Huh?
Yeah, I just saw it on the news, but they have four children.
Check on that after church. Anything else? If not, y'all have a good week.
This is Memorial Day weekend. And on Memorial Day, we remember. We honor those men and women of our military who have given the ultimate sacrifice so that we can enjoy freedom and liberty. So certainly as we go to prayer, we want to keep that in our minds as well. Let's pray. Lord God, as we come to you, we lift up the many matters for prayer that we've mentioned. We pray, Lord God, that you would be with each one. We lift up a special prayer today for the families of those service people who gave their lives, enabling us to enjoy liberty and freedom. We thank you too, Lord God, for those disciples who have influenced us and helped us to be disciples of Christ. And Lord God, help us so to order our lives that people who do not know Jesus will know Jesus and become disciples, and that we can help disciple them so that all might be faithful followers of Jesus Christ. We join now in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Crystal clear river where it's been.
Let's join now in our prayer of illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds
by the power of your Holy Spirit,
that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen.
This morning I'm reading from Psalm 1, verses 1 through 6. Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all that they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. This is the word of the God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I invite us now to stand and let's join together in our affirmation of faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Our next song is Thy Word is a Lamp unto My Feet. It's 601 in the hymn. Trip to Fredericksburg, and my brother joined us and a part of it, and we had a nice time. I just thank you for making that possible. Grateful to Renita for filling in, and just appreciate y'all more than you know. So we're going to start a new series in the on the Psalms. And so we're going to take off on that. So in a recent Gallup poll, they found that more than half of Americans, when they experience grief, turn to God. They pray and read scripture for comfort, and of those, 94% said that it is highly effective. You know, and they ask the question, well, where else do you turn when you're in your darkest time? Where, and it doesn't look like the light's going to come. So there's a man named Robert, and Robert was a man who seemingly had everything. He was the CEO of a large development company in Boston, millions of dollars in revenue, like 50 or so employees. But the market changed, and his company went out of business, went bankrupt. And he was really distraught over it because he felt like his company was a company that helped people when they were in need. But not only did his company go bankrupt, seemingly his life did too. His father passed away, his father-in-law passed away, and then his wife and his child both got sick and spent extended times in the hospital. In the account, Robert says he was driving home and he couldn't even go any further. He stops his car, pulls over on the side of the road, stops his car, gets out, falls to his knees, and he starts praying to God for help. He said he felt he had hit rock bottom. And as he prayed, he didn't really believe anything could help him. But he recounts that when he stood up, something extraordinary had happened. He said for the first time, there was lightness. There was a clarity, there was a sense of peace that had not been there before. He goes on to say that he had not been at church for many years, and he started going back to church, and he began reading the Bible. And he found the Psalms to be especially helpful, and they had meaning for his life. And he was really drawn to Psalm 30, and there's a verse there that says, "As for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved." And he said that through that verse, he came to realize that he had the sin of overconfidence. But he goes on to say that from the time he knelt by the side of his car, his life was changed from that point forward. The Psalms, the commentary that I have, said the Psalms model praise and devotion. They flow from the hearts of people who know the living God. We get into the Psalms, psalm is a word that comes from the Greek that can mean stringed instruments. It also can mean a collection of songs. The Psalms, one way to look at the Psalms is like a hymnal, even, or a prayer book. If you grab one of our hymnals there in the pew and start kind of looking through it, this is a great thing to do during the sermon. That's just a little tip. So, but if you grab the hymnal and started going through it, you'd see a lot of songs there. You'd see prayers there. You would see services there. You know, the liturgy we do on Communion Sundays is there. The wedding service is there. The service, there's a funeral service there. There's a whole lot in there. Prayers, songs, all of that. Well, the Psalms in the Bible, in many ways, I think we can look at it as an original, or maybe the first hymnal, the first book of prayer, if you will. Psalms, they say that scholars attribute 73 plus or minus a few to David. You know, and many of them will have the heading at the top, a Psalm of David. And remember, David was a man after God's own heart. The Bible tells us that in many places. And sometimes we struggle with that. I know sometimes I struggle with that. You know, David committed adultery. David conspired to commit murder. But yet when David was confronted, he sought forgiveness from God, and God forgave him. Now, that's not to say there weren't consequences. There were dire consequences for David and members of his family because of the sins he had committed. But what happened through all of that is David is recognized in the Old Testament and the New Testament as a man after God's own heart. And at almost half of our Psalms, there's 150 chapters in the book of Psalms, almost half of those are said to be written by David. There are different types of Psalms. One of the resources I was looking at, since there are Psalms where you pray, where individuals are praying for help. And then there are other Psalms where it's a whole community or even a country that's praying for help. There's Psalms that deal with thanksgiving, individuals offering thanks, or even groups of people or countries offering things. There are hymns of praise. There are Psalms of praise. There's Psalms of instruction, where there seems to be a teaching or knowledge being conveyed, even wisdom being conveyed. In fact, Psalm 1, the one that we're going to look at here in just a second, that psalm is considered perhaps a psalm of instruction. There's another writer who says there's really only two types of psalms. One is a psalm of praise, the other is a psalm of lament. A lament is kind of crying out for help. So psalm of praise, psalm of lament. The one scholar says you can divide the psalms just between those two categories. We're reading Colossians 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. With gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. So a neighbor was dropping in on her friend, and she goes next door, goes in the back door to the kitchen, and her neighbor has just got her head down on the table. There's about half a cup of what appears to be very cold coffee there, and the kids are at the table, and they are just, they're just half crazy, she feels. And so she asks her neighbor, she said, "Marge, what's wrong?" And Marge says, "Well, I have morning sickness." And the neighbor was stunned there. So, "Oh no, I had no idea you were expecting." And Marge quickly says, "Oh no, I'm not expecting. I just am sick of mornings." And sometimes we get to that point. Like Robert from the first story, we get to the point where we can't go any farther. We can't go any farther. There was another woman, Stephanie Pirro. She said that behind every successful woman is a substantial amount of coffee. That's just a tip that really doesn't fit anywhere, but I thought, that's interesting. I'll offer that as a tip. Our psalm, Psalm 1, starts off with happy. Happier those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, take the path of sinners, tread or sit in the seat of scoffers. And in the scriptures, when you see the word happy, the other word that could be there, if the translators had wanted, is the word blessed or blessed. To me, the beginning of Psalm 1 reminds me of the Beatitudes in Matthew 5, where basically phrase after phrase after phrase begins with happy is the one. Blessed, depending on your translation, blessed is the one. And I think it has more to do than with just happiness. I think it has to do with a sense of inner well-being, even an inner joy, an inner peace that's far beyond just kind of what I think of as happy. Most of the times when I think of if I'm happy or not, it's kind of a very superficial emotion or feeling, where I think the blessedness and the happiness in Scripture is something that goes quite a bit deeper. So many people in our world today spend their lives in search for happiness, for pleasure, for fun. They're bored with their lives, and they mope around fantasizing for some sort of secret to find this joy somewhere. A son goes to his dad and says, "I'm looking for adventure, excitement, and beautiful women. And you don't try to stop me," tells his dad. His father responds, "Who wants to stop you? I'm going with you." But the thing is, when we go after those things, we wind up with less. The happiness that we seek, the adventure that we seek, will leave us even more empty than when we started. Because true happiness, true blessedness, doesn't come from our activities, it comes from God. And that's the irony, that as we seek those kinds of pleasures, it brings very little joy. And in fact, folks who seek that the hardest are often the ones that are the most unhappy. Psalm 1, I think, gives us a clear message that we need to watch the company we keep. We need to stay away from bad company, from folks who are wicked, criminal, guilty, from folks who are sinners, who are intent on doing things that are against the ways of God. For scoffers, I looked up in a dictionary of the original language, in a dictionary of the original language for the word scoffers is the word arrogant. People who are arrogant. And there's a transition. So we want to avoid the wicked. We want to avoid the sinners or the scoffers. And then verse 2, but their delight, these are the people who are happy, these are the people who are blessed, their delight is the law of the Lord. And on his law, they meditate day and night. Anytime we see the word law in the scriptures, think right away to the first 5 books of the Old Testament. Those are the books of Moses. Those are the books that are understood to be the law. The Hebrew word for that is Torah. But our word law tends to make us think of Austin or think of Washington, D.C. And we think of, well, here's a whole bunch of list of things we can't do or regulations or stuff that kind of mess up our life. And that's not the way the Bible understands law. That's not really what Torah means. What Torah means more than that is really a way of life, a way to live that will bring fulfillment, a way to live that will bring that blessedness and happiness that we're talking about. It has much more of a positive and helpful connotation than sometimes our hearing of the word law in English. Also, as you look at Psalm 1, verse 1 about not following, the words there really have to do with movement. They have to do with getting up, going, walking, departing. And so there's a real sense of not just, you know, having company, but actually going to folks and being with folks as you go and do things. And so as we want to be intentional about the folks we're around, and we want to avoid those folks that are going to somehow move us away from the way that God wants us to be. In a sense, what I feel that we have here is that there are two paths to take. There's the path that we can take to go and be with the folks that are wicked, the folks that are sinners, the folks that are scoffers, or there's a path that we can take where we wind up meditating on the law, on the ways of God, on the things that God wants us to do. And we get a choice to take one of those paths. But so often, I know, I think what I try to do, and maybe many of us try to do, is we try to take both paths at the same time. We want to be doing maybe some of the stuff or be with some of the people that are up to the stuff that we shouldn't be up to. But we also want to be able to say, oh, well, I'm doing what God wants me to do. And my sense of it is those paths maybe start close to the same place, but they eventually get further and further apart. And it becomes impossible to be doing both. So you wind up doing one and pretending about the other one. Verse 3 is what makes me think about a picnic in Psalm 1. They're like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season. Their leaves do not wither, and all they do, they prosper. And that made me, I don't know why, that verse always kind of makes me think of a picnic. And I got to thinking about picnics, and you know, I think the best picnics I've been to have been in the movies. You know, like the one in Sound of Music, where the Alps and all real nice, that's a good picnic. Or there's a picnic in Catch a Thief, there's a In Star Wars Episode 2, there's kind of a fun picnic where there's a love story unfolding there. And these picnics, I enjoy those. I find that picnics I go to often are not as enjoyable. Because you got the bugs, and you got, you know, there's just a lot of issues you wind up dealing with in picnics where you know, the picnics and the movies are clean and they're usually good in the air conditioning, really nice. But the verse is talking about our journey, meditating on the law, meditating on God's ways. I'll tell you one picnic we went to. We were, Nancy and I were traveling. We only had one child. This was a long time ago. And John wasn't even 1 year old. He was walking, so he was older than 10 months. John started walking early, and so probably 11 months. We're doing the real picnic thing. We have a blanket on the ground. We were at a rest area somewhere, and at the rest area there was like a tank that they had built up there, pretty big man-made lake over there. And we're probably, I don't know, 20, 25 feet away from the bank, and we're on the blanket, down on the blanket. I wouldn't do that now because I'd never get up. You'd never see me again. But we're down there, and John starts to walk towards the lake. You know, and I watched him for about 4 feet, and I said, I guess I need to get up. And so I get up, and I'm looking at John, and he's getting right to the bank, and I'm like, okay, he's going to stop. Nope, John didn't stop. He just kept going into this lake. Thankfully, there was a kind of a gradual depth. It wasn't like he stepped in the water and just sunk. But he was up to his knees, almost his waist. I mean, his knees and his waist at less than one are about the same thing. He was about to his knees. Before I grabbed him and pulled him in, and you see why I enjoy those movie picnics so much. We have a choice to choose the way we're going to go. Are we going to choose the wicked? Are we going to choose the way of sinners, the way of the scoffers? Are we going to choose the ways of God? You know, and our world's message to us, if we want to pay attention to what the world wants to tell us, the world wants to tell us this way of God is a fraud. The way of God is just trying to keep you from something that's better. But the way of the world will leave us empty, will leave us further from God, and will take us to a place where we will have no hope in our life. The way of God leads us into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Christ's death on a cross and resurrection from the grave offer to all of us the opportunity to be in a relationship with God, to be considered one of God's. And we get to choose. Which path will we choose to take? One of the reasons I've been so blessed by the covenant groups that we've started is it's a chance each week for a small group of folks to check in on the way they're choosing to go. Check in about prayer and about worship and about loving neighbor. And that's one of the, I think, the great benefits of our covenant groups. If you want to check into those or talk to me about those, we can get you more information about that. Which path are we going to choose? The path of the wicked, the scoffers, the sinners, or the path of meditating on the ways of God? Let's pray. Lord God, help us to choose you. We pray, Lord God, that you would come and you would just remind us that every day, every moment of every day is an opportunity for us to choose you and choose your way. Lord God, for all the times that we have not chosen your ways, we ask you to to forgive us. We pray, Lord God, that you would guide our steps so that we would faithfully follow Jesus Christ. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
church have remained solvent through all of the COVID and continue to do so. We want to remind everyone that the offering plates are up here at the rail. There's one in the back. There's one in the office area. I always feel sort of like a flight attendant when I'm doing this stuff. The baskets up on the rail are for our rail offering, and the rail offering in May is going to the Methodist retirement communities. I want to read from Colossians chapter 3. Whatever you do, do it from the heart for the Lord and not for people. You know that you will receive an inheritance as a reward. You serve the Lord Christ. If you would mail us an offering, our address is Post Office Box 267, Normangee 77871. I invite you to stand and let's join together singing our doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly world. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Our hymn of commitment is Trust and Obey. It is 467. Son and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.